Now, we straight away go towards the oriental communication. As I mentioned, it is nothing but the opening into the maxillary sinus. It is an unnatural communication between oral cavity and maxillary sinus. That's your simple definition. If it is even asked in exam, it's an unnatural communication. So what are the causes of oral communication? Most important cause in a day-to-day clinical practice, one can come across is extraction of posterior teeth. It could be premolar or molar, followed by infections of the maxillary sinus, surgical removal of cysts and tumors of the posterior maxilla. It can be because of the trauma. It can be because of the periodontal infection. One can have a oral-antral communication. So this particular slide is showing you about the extraction of the posterior tooth where chunk of the bone has come out and patient has developed oral-antral communication. Now, another thing which I am going to discuss is oral-antral fistula. As I told you, most of the examiners will ask you what is the difference between oral-antral communication and oral-antral fistula. Undoubtedly, oral-antral fistula is also again a passage. But if you don't treat oral-antral communication, if you leave it like that, it will get converted into fistula. It's a fistula tract where there is a granulation tissue around. So, what are the etiological factors? Infections in antrum and dentolar infections. Other factors like Paget's disease, destruction of the portion of the sinus by cyst and tumors. There could be some iatrogenic causes like during orthognathic surgery, following failure of the primary healing of oral-antral communication. As I told you in the beginning only, if you don't treat oral-antral communication, it will get converted into oral-antral fistula. And if you don't treat oral-antral fistula, that will become a chronic oral-antral fistula and patient will develop chronic maxillary sinusitis. You tend to get short notes on oral-antral communication, oral-antral fistula, chronic maxillary sinusitis. You have to see what kind of question has been asked. If it is a communication, it is within the 24 hours or immediate opening of maxillary sinus. Fistula, after 24 hours. Chronic maxillary sinusitis causing, if you don't treat oral-antral fistula, if it remains chronically, then you land up with the chronic oral-antral fistula. That's how you need to answer it. So what are the signs and symptoms of oral-antral communication? Once you remove that particular tooth, could be because of extensive ankylosis of the tooth, or there could be dense bone, bony fragment will come attached with the tooth and you have a oral-antral opening. You can have a floor of the maxillary sinus attached to the tooth. You can have a maxillary tuberosity coming out with the help of with third molar. During removal of some root pieces which are gone in the sinus, or during removal of some small cysts and tumors, one can have a oral-antral communication, and which will cause fogging of the mirror. One can see the huge chunk of the bone which has come with the posterior tooth. This will create a oral-antral communication. You need to have good radiograph to see this particular oral-antral communication. So what are the signs and symptoms of oral-antral communication? Especially early symptoms and late symptoms. What are the early symptoms? Patient will immediately tell you there is an escape of fluid from the nose. Immediately after extraction, patient will tell you, I'm getting the regurgitation of fluid. Epistaxis, because there is going to be bleeding within the maxillary sinus, which is going to come out to the nostrils. Escape of air from mouth into nose. Enhanced column of air that will create altered voice. And in some cases, there will be severe pain. Not necessarily will have a severe pain. So in short, you need to write 5 E's. Then what are the late symptoms? You need to write 5 P's. Patient might develop chronic pain, persistent purulent discharge because you have not treated that particular oral-antral communication, and which will have a persistent foul smell. Then postnasal drip, and you will have a popping out of a oral-antral polyp. These are the signs of oral-antral fistula or late symptoms of oral-antral fistula. So how do you investigate this? On clinical examination, we will see socket. There can be osseous defect to the naked eye. It can have a nose blowing test, one can have this cotton wool test, all full of water you can give to the patient, you can ask patient to rinse, that will come out to the nostrils, transillumination test, and there are certain radiographs one can do at IOPA, then you can have IOPA with the help of beta fascia, lateral radiograph, OPG, CT scan, and in cases of chronic orantum fistula, one can take a simple radiograph, that's a paranasal sinus view, Waters view, which will show you about chronic maxillary sinusitis. So these are the various investigations one can do for orantal fistula. Now we'll come towards the management of orantal communication. Management depends if no displacement of the tooth or root, if communication is small, how you should manage. If communication is bigger, how you could manage. This can be viral patient, this can be theory patient. If it is a simple, very small communication to the maxillary sinus, don't disturb the clot. At the most, give a good pressure pack and do proper suturing. Don't ask patient to do nasal blowing, gargling. Just go ahead with the simple suturing, give a good pack, that will heal on its own. If it is a bigger, then you smoothen the margins, reduce the alveolar height, so that while suturing, you don't suture that particular orantal communication under tension. So you take a buccal or palatal flap, mobilize it nicely and do the suturing without any tension. So there has to be no tension on your suture line. And you can support that suture line with the help of good acrylic plate, which you can reconstruct by taking patient's impression. If tooth is displaced in a maxillary sinus, then you need to locate that particular root or a tooth with the help of radiograph. You have to enlarge the socket. If it is possible, remove the particular root piece from the socket itself by enlarging the socket. And then again, you go ahead with the same procedure what we talked, buccal and palatal advancement flap. And if it is not possible to retrieve the root piece through your normal socket, then you can go ahead with the palvular surgery. Now, this is again one of the most commonly asked questions, palvular surgery. So, what is the palvular surgery? It was described by Calvin in 1893. It's nothing but entering into the maxillary sinus through the canine fossa. Now, they will ask you, from where do you enter the maxillary sinus? So, above the canine fossa. Why canine fossa? Because longest root is going to be your maxillary canine. So you go above the canine apices, so you don't disturb the root apices of the teeth. From there you approach the maxillary sinus. So what are the indications for palvular surgery? One indication we just saw, removal of the root fragments, teeth which are pushed into the maxillary sinus during normal exodontia. Any foreign body, it can be your tooth, it can be implant while doing the sinus procedures. One can easily appreciate that the implant displacement in the maxillary sinus. So that is also foreign body, retrieval of the foreign body. Then chronic maxillary sinusitis treatment. Again, as I told you, you tend to get a chronic maxillary sinusitis short note where you are supposed to write about palvular surgery to treat chronic maxillary sinusitis to remove infected sinus lining. You do palvular surgery, that's one of the indications. Removal of some cyst and tumors from arising from the maxillary sinus. Management of the hematoma, which is there in the maxillary sinus. Rhizomatous complex fracture, where you give a maxillary sinus balloon. Then orantal fistula in cases of chronic sinusitis. So these are the indications for the palvular surgery. Now, we just quickly go through the fistula. It develops when communication fails to close, which I have already talked about it. There is an epithelialization, which occurs after 48 to 72 hours. Within few days, fistula gets organized and gets epithelialized and which develops good bony margins, and then one can, it will look like this. So there is going to be epithelialized margin and patient will have chronic signs and symptoms of maxillary sinusitis as well as oroantral fistula signs and symptoms like regurgitation of fluid, regurgitation, epistaxis will not be there because there is no bleeding in the maxillary sinus. So one should realize what question has been asked. So this can be also one of the reasons various cysts and tumors arising from maxillary sinus that can create a chronic oral fistula. So in short, signs and symptoms of the oral fistula: nasal regurgitation of liquid, altered nasal tone, unilateral nasal discharge, difficulty in sucking the fluid with a straw, bad taste because of first discharge, and patient is unable to whistle. They are and there is going to be escape of air, and they are worried why I'm unable to whistle, and there's going to be chronic dull pain. Patient may not have severe acute pain because there is a drainage, continuous drainage. So patient will not have acute pain, but definitely patient is going to have other symptoms like, as I told you, regurgitation, bad taste, problem in whistling. So how to manage this? Simple basic principles. First, sinus must be free of any infection. Otherwise, if you close this particular fistula, again it is going to come out. Again it is going to recur. So you need to take care of sinus lining, which is epithelial. So we have to remove the infected sinus lining and then close it. So successful closure of oral fistula should be done with the help of sinus pathology removal. So what are the different techniques for the closure of oral fistula? It can be buccal clasp, it can be palatal clasp, autogenous distance clasp, autogenous bone graft. So we'll just quickly go through. One can see the root piece which has gone in the maxillary sinus, which is retrieved to the with the calvular surgery, and there is a buccal advancement clasp. So this is a buccal advancement clasp. For exam, you need to draw nice diagram. If you have drawn such a beautiful diagram of oral fistula and buccal advancement clasp, that is the one Rehrman's clasp, no examiner is going to read your answer completely. Your diagram is self-explanatory. So this particular case, one can see the oral fistula, one can see the freshening of the margin of oral fistula by excision of sinus tract or a fistula, then a buccal advancement clasp, that's the Rehrman's clasp, and clasp is advanced towards the fistula and it is sutured towards the palatal side. So this is a closure of oral fistula. In addition to that closure, you need to give an acrylic plate to support your clasp. So what are the disadvantages of this particular clasp? You are going to have a less vestibular depth. Though this particular clasp is a very versatile, it is a immediate distance clasp. It's very easy to harvest this particular clasp. You don't have to go very far. So bigger disadvantage, you can have a decrease in depth of the vestibule. Another clasp, self-explanatory. There is a clasp which is taken from the palatal slide. It is based on your palatal artery, that's the greater palatal artery. It's a highly vascular. Again, what is the disadvantage? You are going to leave dry area on the palate and it's going to be extremely painful. But it's an excellent clasp to cover your fistula. Again, it's going to be epithelialized clasp. So there is going to be nice epithelialization. Dense epithelialization is going to be there. So that's a palatal clasp. One more way, by putting the buccal fat pad, which is again a localized clasp, which is readily available from patient itself. One can pedicle the buccal fat pad and put it in a fistula. After in this particular clasps, one can have a Moxey's clasp, then tongue clasp. Both the clasps have some disadvantages. Moxey's clasp, definitely you are going to disturb the dental status of the patient. Tongue clasp, again it is going to be a little problematic for the phonation. In short, you need to draw this particular flow chart. If it is asked as a full question, if it is a short note, restrict your answer to the simple definition, etiological factors, signs, symptoms, various ways of closure. See how many mark questions it has come. In Viva also, see what has been asked, whether the exam is asking you oral fistula or communication, chronic or acute. So in short, if size of perforation is less than 5 millimeters, you have to localize it, then you can do the procedures which I have mentioned. I'm not going to go in details of all these procedures which we have already talked about. What are the post-operative management of oral fistula? You need to avoid trauma to that particular site. What happens? once you put a palatal plate or once you put sutures, patients are tend to put their tongue over there. So instruct patient not to put their tongue over there, not to eat very hard food, so patient's suture line is getting disturbed. Avoid physical activities which will cause severe pressure within the maxillary sinus. They have to restrict nose blowing, strictly no nose blowing. If they have to sneeze, they need to open their mouth, and to that patient should open the mouth while coughing and sneezing. Avoid rolling of tongue over the suture line. Wound should be kept clean by doing good saline, water saline goggles or chlorhexidine or betadine goggles, and use of straw or smoking has to be completely prohibited. Use of steam inhalation to have a good sinus healing. You need to put the patient on good antibiotics. Amoxicillin and clavulanic acid is a drug of choice. Patient has to be on some decongestant. Keep nasal opening patent by doing a nasal antistomy, and painkillers like NSAIDs and